Hello friends, the Maharaja Airlines, that is Air India, has come back to its original owner, the Tata Group. This is an iconic moment in the Indian civil aviation industry. Also on 13th October, friends, all the Tata Group stocks surged in the stock market and it can well be called as the Tata's day out in the stock market. So in this video, I thought of doing a case study about the man who founded this amazing Indian business empire, the Tata Group. And it is none other than Jamsetji Nasarwanji Tata. So let's dive into this video. Hello friends, my name is Karthik and my mission is to spread the knowledge about the world of commerce under one umbrella, which is Combrella. Jamsetji Nasarwanji Tata was born on 3rd March 1839 in a small town called Navsari in the state of Gujarat. He was the first child and the only son of Nasarwanji Tata and Jeevanbai Tata. Many generations of the Tata family friends had actually joined the Parsi priesthood and had become Parsi priest. And the Tata surname actually means one who is short-tempered or hot-tempered. But it was Nasarwanji Tata, the father of Jamsetji Tata, who had broken this tradition and was the first member of the family to try his hand into the world of business. So Nasarwanji Tata shifted to Bombay for the purpose of business, where he started a small trading firm named Nasarwanji and Kalyan Das along with his friend. Jamsetji was raised in Navsari and then later came to Bombay to live with his father when he was just 14 years old. And he joined the Elphinstone College in Bombay, where he passed out in the year 1858 as a Green Scholar, equivalent to today's graduate. He loved academics, reading lot of books, and also worked in the solicitor's office for a brief period of time, but soon discovered that his life's true calling was business. Then he joined his father's export trading firm in the year 1859 when he was just 20 years old. Just to tell you friends, doing business in those days was very difficult, as Britishers had just crushed the Sepoy mutiny in the year 1857, the revolt of 1857, also known as the First War of Independence. But Jamsetji worked with his father extensively and acquired great business acumen. He also used to travel abroad for various business trips to places such as Hong Kong, Japan, China, England. And also by going on these business trips, he acquired immense knowledge about the business world and the prospects of business all around the world. Then, having worked with his father and gaining experience for 9 years, he started a trading company of his own with a capital of 21,000 rupees when he was 29 years. He then went to England to learn about the textile business and the cotton industry boom of the West, as he was sure that there was tremendous scope for Indian companies to make good business in textiles in India. So in 1869, friends, he acquired an old bankrupt oil mill in Chinchpokali, Mumbai, and renamed it as Alexandra Mills and then converted it into a cotton mill. And then just within 2 years, he sold that cotton mill to a local cotton merchant for a good amount of profits. So with good amount of money in his hand, he then decided to scale up his business. After this, he again went to England to understand the Lancashire cotton trade, the quality of machinery, the skills needed, as he was convinced that the cotton revolution of the West could be brought to India also. And at that time, friends, Bombay was the favorite location for textiles, but Jamsetji decided to do otherwise. So in 1874, he floated a fresh company called as Central India Spinning, Weaving and Manufacturing Company with a seed capital of 1.5 lakh rupees in Nagpur, Maharashtra, and not Bombay. He decided on Nagpur for three main reasons, right? The first one was close proximity to cotton growing areas in the Maharashtrian belt of Nagpur. So raw material was easily available. The second was easy access to railway station, logistics could be sorted. And the third was good supply of water and fuel, which is the coal. So on 1st January 1877, the mill came into existence and was known as the Empress Mills. He used the ring frame technology in the Empress Mills of Nagpur before even it was extensively used in the West. This doubled the production and the share prices of the company increased tremendously. All these things made Jamsetji a pioneer in the business world. Then friends, his next step was in 1886 when he purchased the Sikh Dharamsi Mills, then the largest in the Bombay Presidency, despite the expert advice not to purchase it because it was under liquidation for many years and was considered a symbol of bad luck. But Jamsetji weighed the advantages of buying a ready-made mill on a freehold land available for 1/6 of its original price. He acquired it, renamed it into Swadeshi Mills to mark the beginning of the Swadeshi movement in India. Turning around this mill into a profitable one was one of the most challenging tasks of Jamsetji. There were labor shortages, poor equipment, shipments were returned, and 2 years later the mill failed to pay a dividend. Its early shipment of coarse yarn was rejected in the China market and the share price of the company fell to 1/4 of its initial value. But Jamsetji friends did not give up. He scrapped the antiquated machinery and through a remarkable show of energy, business acumen and sacrifice, Jamsetji put in his private funds and went to the bank for an overdraft. He had actually made a trust for his family and offered that as a pledge to the bank. He sold the shares of his Empress Mills in Nagpur, pumped in more capital, got new engines, new boilers, new shed. He also brought the best of his people from the Nagpur mills and also got the modernized machinery, even though this Swadeshi mill was incurring losses heavily. His efforts finally paid off a decade later when the Swadeshi mill's yarn fetched the highest prices in the Far Eastern market and became one of the few that could compete successfully with the Lancashire cotton mills. By this time, friends, Jamsetji was becoming a more astute businessman and his business empire was growing steadily day by day. In his life, Jamsetji had three big ideas in his mind for India as well as the Tata Group, which were very close to his heart, but none of them could see the light of the day during his lifetime. The first one was building an iron and steel company in India, which is now known as Tata Steel. The second one was generating hydroelectric power, which is the Tata Power Company currently. And the third one was building a world-class education institution in India, which is the Indian Institute of Science in Bangalore. Though none of these ideas could materialize in his lifetime, the seeds were sown by him. The idea of iron and steel industry had come to Jamsetji when he was on one of his business visits to England to check out the new machinery for his textile mill. There he attended one of the lectures where he came to know that the country which gains the control of iron soon gains the control of gold, and then that country becomes economically powerful. It is after this incident that his quest for iron started. He could not see his dream of building the iron and steel company materialize in his lifetime, but his son Dorabji Tata ensured that his father's dream was ultimately fulfilled. Similarly friends, the idea of hydroelectric power. By the end of 19th century, Bombay had lot of pollution due to heavy industrialization and setting up of many cotton industries and textile mills and so on. So Jamsetji wanted to provide clean power and make Bombay a smokeless city. So in 1875, during the survey of falls of Jabalpur, where the Narmada water gushes between the famous marble rocks, Jamsetji envisioned harnessing the power of water to provide clean renewable energy. But again, this idea also couldn't see the light of the day during his lifetime. The third idea of building a world-class education institution came to Jamsetji as he believed that if India has to climb out of poverty, then its finest minds have to be harnessed. So he established a J.N. Tata Endowment Fund in 1892 so that Indian students could pursue higher studies around the world. And then he ultimately decided that India needs to have a world-class institution of its very own. And this dream also came to reality after Jamshedji had left for the heavenly abode. But there was one big dream which materialized in his lifetime and was by far the biggest business achievement of Jamshedji, which was the Taj Mahal Palace Hotel in Mumbai. Legend has it that Jamshedji had set his mind on building it after he was being denied entry into one of the city's hotels for being an Indian, as he had went along with his foreign friend, and he decided to take a revenge by building one of them. And the construction of the Taj Mahal Palace Hotel started in the year 1898, and by the time of its completion in 1903, the Taj costed 4.21 crore rupees back then. Soaked in luxury, it was the first building in Bombay to use electricity, the first hotel in the country to have American fans, German elevators, Turkish baths, English butlers, and so many other things. It was built 21 years before the Gateway of India. Building this hotel during the time of British rule shows that Jamshedji was not an ordinary businessman, friends. He was class apart. Friends, we all know that Tata Group is known for employee welfare measures and taking good care of its employees. But it was Jamshedji Tata who started this tradition in the Tata Group. He introduced 8-hour working days for the workers in his mills. He even employed women workforce and had crèche for younger mothers and medical dispensaries for men and women. He started the Provident Fund scheme, the Gratuity Fund scheme, all this much before they had become statutory regulations in India and even in the Western world. He introduced the concept of leave with the pay, the system of apprenticeship, and in 1886, he instituted a pension fund, and in 1895, he began to pay accident compensation to the workers. He had also planned the concept of the township for the workers at the iron and steel plant, which is now the Jamshedpur, in which he wanted to have wide streets with trees along the sides of the road, which will give shade, with plenty of space for gardens and lawns and playing areas for football, hockey and other sports, and keeping earmarked areas for temples, mosques and churches. Due to this, friends, if you see, Tata Steel hasn't seen a single strike since the year 1929. Jamshedji never sacrificed employee welfare for the sake of profits. Welfare of employees came first and then profits for Jamshedji Tata. And it is this tradition which he started that is still being continued by the Tata Group till now. Jamshedji donated generously for healthcare and education and is awarded as the greatest philanthropist of the 20th century, when his total donation estimated was around $102 billion adjusted for inflation. So friends, such a remarkable life with Jamshedji. He passed away in the year 1904 in Germany on 19th of May. Though his life ended at that time, but his legacy and his dream and the vision for India still continues. He was decades ahead of his time, miles ahead of its competitors, and is rightly known as the father of Indian industry. Salute to such a man who became a legend through his actions and made India and Indians proud of its motherland. Thank you, friends, for watching this video. I hope you all liked it. Please let me know in the comment section about your thoughts on this video and whether you want to know anything more about any other great businessmen also. I'll see you all in the next episode. Till then, this is Karthik signing off. Thank you and Namaste.